So, our next session is about understanding what communication difficulties are and how support groups can help. I'm really excited for this session as we have so many experts joining us today who want to share with you their experience and knowledge. After today, we really hope you will have more tools to be able to support your group members with their communication. So today you'll hear from Caitlin and Janet. They are part of our accessibility team here at the Stroke Association, and Janet is also a group leader. And then we have three volunteers from different support groups, Colin, Heidi, and Jim, and they're going to share their experiences with you. So, to kick us off, I will welcome both Caitlin and Janet, and they will take us in to this second session. Thank you.
Oh, they're so welcome, and we hope you find this session useful and interesting.
Can we get the slides up, please? Thank you so much.
Right. Yeah. So I'm Janet Rockliffe, the accessible assistant, and I run the Kendall Speakability Group, and I'm a stroke survivor.
Hi everyone. As Beth so nicely said, my name is Caitlin Longman and I'm the accessibility lead here at the Stroke Association. I'm also a speech and language therapist by background. You might notice on some of our slides today that there's a little star in the top left-hand corner. Don't worry about that at all. That's just a helpful little guide for me and Janet to know when we need to speak on the slides. Next slide. So let's start off by saying what accessibility means to us here at the Stroke Association. So you heard a bit from Juliet this morning about how we are prioritizing accessibility. So accessibility means making any information, activities, and the environment as sensible, meaningful, and usable for as many people as possible. So that might be adapting how we share information in our group, maybe changing how we do an activity so everyone can engage, and making sure where we're meeting as a group has the right space for wheelchairs or has ramps for entry. Next slide. Now, after a stroke, there are a number of different accessibility needs that someone might experience. It could be around mobility, vision, hearing, or cognition. But today we're really going to be focusing on communication, and we're going to be talking about some key resources that you can use within your group. Next slide.
So what we'll be talking about today. So stroke and communication difficulties, communication tips, communication support pack, and accessible resources for the group. Next slide.
So, I'm not sure if anyone has seen these statistics before, but in the UK, we know that there is 14.1 million people living with a disability. Now, that's a really large audience of individuals who might need additional support. Every one in five individuals in the UK are experiencing some sort of long-term illness, impairment, or disability. And it's important for us to know and remember that anyone can experience a disability at any point in their lives. But also, the access needs that we require can change over time. So, what you may be needed when you first had your stroke could be very different to what you might need today. Next slide.
So, communication difficulties. About two-thirds of people have communication problems soon after a stroke. Some people will have a long-term communication problem. It's different for everybody. Next slide.
So we wanted to talk a little bit about the three main types of communication difficulties that you could experience after a stroke, and we're going to go into each one in a bit more detail. So the first one is aphasia. Some people might also experience dysarthria, and others may experience apraxia of speech. Now, it's important to remember that people can have different severities of each of these. So somebody might experience a mild aphasia where they may have difficulty getting a word out that they're trying to find in a sentence. So instead of saying pass the salt, they might say pass me the and take a bit of time to find the right word. Where other people may have a more severe impact and they will be unable to say any words. It's also important to remember that people can have a combination of these different types of communication difficulties. So someone may experience aphasia and dysarthria, or aphasia and apraxia of speech. It's also worth mentioning that there are different types of aphasia and different types of dysarthria, but we don't have time to go into those today. Next slide. So let's start with talking a little bit about aphasia. Aphasia is when the language areas of your brain have been damaged. About 40% of stroke survivors will experience aphasia soon after their stroke. Aphasia masks your language abilities, but it does not mean that you are any less intelligent. Next slide.
Aphasia can be cause problems with speaking, understanding what people are saying, finding the right words, reading, writing, using numbers. Next slide.
Now, dysarthria is quite different from aphasia because aphasia affects language, whereas dysarthria and apraxia of speech are affecting the speech of an individual. So what is dysarthria? Dysarthria is when there is weakness in the muscles, and this could be weakness in the muscles in your mouth or in your throat. This can make it really difficult to speak, but it can also make it difficult to eat or drink. Often people with dysarthria may sound like their speech is quite slurred. And it's very common after a stroke for people to experience dysarthria. Over half of all stroke survivors will have experienced this at some point. Next slide. Now, apraxia of speech is different to dysarthria because it's not about the weakness of the muscles. It's about coordinating the movements of those muscles. So coordinating the muscles of your mouth and your tongue. Individuals who have apraxia of speech might find that when they try to say a word, the word sounds a little bit wrong, or they might be trying to get a word out and unable to say it. You might notice in your group somebody moving their lips or their tongue, trying to form the word in their mouth, and maybe it takes them a bit longer to get it out. That might be a sign of apraxia. Next slide.
So other things that can affect communications, so fatigue, concentration, memory, vision, hearing, anxiety. And for myself, my vision has been affected after my hemorrhage, but when I eventually got registered partly sighted, I got a lot more help. And tomorrow there's a very interesting talk about the hidden effects of stroke, including fatigue. Next slide. Recovery. You can keep recovering for years. Communication problems can last a long time, and you will recover at your own speed. Next slide. You might not get back to being how you were before the stroke, but you learn to communicate in new ways. Relearn confidence, regain communication. Next slide.
So it's now my honor to introduce you to Colin Lyle. Colin is going to share his top tips for groups in a video shortly. But on this slide, you can see a picture of Colin when he was awarded the Coronation Champion Award for his outstanding contribution as a volunteer. Colin founded the charity Say Aphasia after his stroke in 2013 left him with aphasia. Say Aphasia supports anyone with communication difficulties, regardless of the cause. There are now 15 Say Aphasia support groups across England and Wales, including some online groups. Health professionals are also present at some of the support groups. Colin is also part of his local patient and public voices for the NHS. And on this slide, you can see a wonderful picture of Colin and his wife when they were invited to Buckingham Palace to celebrate the work of extraordinary volunteers across the UK. Colin is in the audience today and will be joining us a little bit later for the Q&A session. But without further ado, let's have a watch of Colin's video.
I'm Colin Lyle. I have aphasia and I'm the founder for Say Aphasia charity. We've got five top tips for people with aphasia. So, one, other people making sure that their words are nice and slow. Very, very easy. Two, when you're having conversations, don't have big, long sentences. For example, today we're going to the shops and then we're going to the swimming and then we're going to our friends and we're going to have a coffee. Our brain is kind of completely what's going on. So making sure that other people, there's a pause for us to work out what they're actually saying. Three, there's obviously people who are quite severe and can't get a whole sentence, can't get the right words. So it's not just the words. There are always other ways in terms of pen, papers, images, gestures, smartphone, etc. So it's always good to talk like this. We don't pretend you understand other people. Making sure that if people are talking, but our brain can't cope, then do say thumbs back down so they know what they're trying to say. And that means you just have to do it again until our brain can get the right words. I think other people with aphasia, making sure that it's not just talking and conversations and practice their words. We need to making sure that there might be a hobby that people have to forget about the old times, about all the things that you can't do. Be positive about all the things that we can do, and making sure that hobbies you can do, walking, swimming, instruments, music, singing, etc. So I think that's my five little tips. We do have a website which has aphasia information pack, and that has some more top tips for people with aphasia. Thank you very much.
That was brilliant. Thank you so much for sharing that with us, Colin. Can we get the slides back up, please? Fabulous. So we are going to talk a little bit about our new communication support pack at the Stroke Association. And before we started developing this pack, we really wanted to get a good idea from people with aphasia, what it is that would be helpful and what was needed. And so we reached out to a number of groups and asked, what is it that you need? And a lot of our groups came back to us and said that they wanted aphasia-friendly information. So information in a highly accessible format that was easy to understand and a bit easier to read. We spoke to the groups about what should be included, and they mentioned lots of topics to help understand their stroke and to understand their communication. And lastly, groups also told us it was really helpful to have images that help you support and understand the meaning of the text. Next slide. So I'm going to talk you through all of the items that you can find now in our communication support pack. So the first two items that you can see on the screen are our two aphasia-friendly guides, one about stroke and one about communication after a stroke. These guides give lots of information about what you might expect and some things you might experience, as well as some key tips to support communication. Next slide. The pack also contains a communication problems after a stroke guide, and this has been written for families and carers. So it includes a lot of the information that you'll find in your aphasia-friendly packs, but in a way that's written directly for your family members to understand. Next slide. We also have a very nifty communication card. This card, as you can see in my screen, is the size to fit into your wallet or fit perfectly into your pocket. And this is incredibly helpful if you're meeting someone for the first time and you want to get across that you might have some communication needs. So if you're going to the bank and meeting someone new, you can hand over this card and they can have a read and they know to slow down and to adapt their communication. There's also the option to add in the communication picture book into your pack. Now, this is a resource for people with more severe communication difficulties who would benefit from pictures to support how they're able to communicate. It includes a number of different topics, but it can help people to make decisions, to ask for things that they need, as well as to express themselves. Next slide.
So who's it for? So people with communication difficulties after a stroke, and their family and friends, carers, healthcare professionals. Next slide.
I'm now delighted to share a video from Heidi Matthews, and she'll also be joining us at the end of the talk to help us answer questions. Heidi had her stroke in 2016, and I feel so fortunate to have known Heidi for a number of years and to have watched her remarkable recovery. Heidi is part of her local stroke group in Wales and is a member of Aphasia and Accessible Voices. Aphasia and Accessible Voices is a group of stroke survivors who have different access needs, but who help us shape our work at the Stroke Association. In this video, Heidi is going to tell us about her experience working on the Stroke Association's new communication support pack.
I'm Heidi Matthews, and I wanted to talk about the pack as a member of Aphasia and Voices. Aphasia and Accessible Voices is a stroke survivor group whose members have different accessibility needs. The group work on Stroke Association projects to make them more accessible. All our sessions are different. We might work on a leaflet or a raffle tag kit or even a big project like the communication support pack. We have 10 members with diverse needs, such as communication, cognitive, vision, hearing, mobility difficulties. The group has been involved in making the pack over the last year and a half. We have been involved from the beginning to the end. We help shape what the images and icons look like. This was a long process, and we had multiple meetings testing different images and the styles. We helped to choose the topics in the guides. For me, the topic of fatigue was really important to me. We look at the text and work to make it easy to understand. We did not want the information to be too wordy and did not want jargon or overly complicated words. As the project developed, we continued to share our ideas. Sometimes we even change our minds about our previous suggestions. It was important that we tested at any of our ideas with other aphasia groups to check we got it right. Over 60 people with aphasia have been involved in the project. In our group, don't always agree with each other, which is great. We are open for discussions, and different views help us to shape the work. We learn from each other's experience because everyone's stroke is different. Making this pack really touched all of us in the group. We wished we had something like this sooner.
Thank you for that, Heidi. It's lovely to hear. Can we get our slides back up? Wonderful. So if you're sitting at home and you're thinking, I would love to order a copy of the Communication Support Pack, I'm just going to very quickly talk you through how you can do that. Please note, you can only order one copy at a time, and you can choose whether you would want a postal hard copy sent to your address, or you can download a copy to your device and read it on your phone or computer, or just print off the pages that you're interested in. Now, you can order this through our website, from the helpline, or through a member of staff. Next page. If you were ordering from our website, this is what the front of our website would look like. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at the top of that page, next slide, and we're going to select About Stroke. So that's the text which is circled in the big red circle. That's going to bring up a few different topics, and we're going to select aphasia and communication. You can see the red arrow pointing to aphasia and communication. Next slide. That takes you to our aphasia pages, and you've got three big buttons to choose from. We're going to select the middle one that says Order a Free Communication Support Pack. Next page. And then it takes you on to ordering your pack. So the start of this page just tells you, like I've done now, a little bit about what's inside the pack, and you can scroll down the page. If you go to our next slide, and it will then start to ask you some questions. So the first question is, would you like the additional communication picture book? Remember, this is a resource for people with severe communication difficulties, so don't order this if you don't think you need it. You'll then be able to select whether you would like to receive your pack by post or email, and you can fill in your details and hit submit. Please note, it will take 2 to 3 weeks for your postal copies to arrive. Next slide. It's now my pleasure to introduce you to Jim Vinus. Jim is the chairman of the Blythe Stroke Group and has been involved in a number of stroke groups over the years. He's one of our members of Aphasia and Accessible Voices, and is also a member of his NHS stroke peer support team, where he works on the ward with stroke survivors offering support. In this video, Jim is going to talk about how his group have used the pack. Over to you, Jim. Thanks for joining me, Jim. Do you mind introducing yourself and telling us what group you belong to?
My name is Jim. As you've said, I'm the chairman of Blythe Stroke Support Group in Northumberland. I also work at NHS peer supporter and work for the Stroke Association and volunteer as a connector.
Brilliant. And are you a member of any other groups at the organisation?
I'm a part of the wonderful Aphasia group. Wonderful Aphasia group.
Not biased at all.
Oh, no.
And Jim, can you tell me how the communication support pack has made a difference in your group?
It's become an amazing tool. The quote I've been using is, why wasn't it there when I had my stroke? It started so many conversations in a form people can understand for the first time, because it comes from us telling our peers what it's like, not the people on the top telling us what we need, we're telling you what we want. That don't make sense, just tell me.
No, that's perfect. I was just pausing in case you wanted to say anything else. And can you tell me why it's important that we have aphasia-friendly resources made by stroke survivors?
Because we truly understand what it's like. We live with this. I was told I would never talk again. My second stroke, I thought was speech was nothing. It took me 15 years to become conversational like this. Long, hard road. But the more work you put in, the more benefit you see. And when we have this resource now, people are actually seeing for the first time that is what's achievable and how to achieve it. But the people with aphasia can sometimes not understand what the doctors and therapists are trying to communicate to them. We're putting it in a way that they can understand.
And do you mind sharing, Jim, how your group has been using the communication and support pack?
What I found works the best for my group was we did one-to-one, checking the individual needs of the person and the carer. What was important to keep the carer in the loop. And we just did an open discussion. And the emotion and the joy that came out of this session was unbelievable. I was nearly moved to tears because the carers finally were seeing what we have to put up with, what we live with. And new light, it was, oh, it was unbelievably good.
So it helped to start a lot of conversations that maybe people haven't had the opportunity to have before?
I think people want to have the conversation, but didn't know where to start. There was a huge need there. It was like a door, that dam breaking. Everybody went, I couldn't, any comments? All hands went up.
It sounds like there was a great conversation. And when you said to people that there was this pack and a few people might have ordered it or you might have helped members to order it, have people used it again and again, or is it something that they just use once, or is it personal?
They use it again and again. They've shared, talked to each other about it. People in my group have been telling other groups. People have been telling their carers, their therapists. It's snowballing. It's fantastic. Debate at the heart of this is unbelievably good. I feel so proud to be a part of this group.
Fabulous. Thank you so much, Jim. That's absolutely perfect.
My pleasure, as always. And I'm just glad to help.
Thanks, Jim. So that was absolutely brilliant to hear from Jim. Unfortunately, Jim couldn't join us today, but he will be catching up with the video afterwards. So any questions, we can always pass those along to Jim. Can we get the final slides up? And before we wrap up today, we have had some questions in the chat. If you can just order one of the communication pack for your group, or if individual members can order a pack. You're more than welcome if an individual member needs that resource to support them to order it. Get it sent to their home directly because it is quite a lot of information and you are welcome to order as many as the group needs. Now, before we wrap up today, we just wanted to touch on a few other resources that your group might find helpful. Now, you might have heard there is a new communication toolkit for groups, which is just being created by the wonderful Julia O'Brien, and that is going to be sent out and shared with groups very, very soon. Inside this toolkit, there's information about how you can adapt your activities, how you might want to adapt some of your writing, as well as some tips that you might want to give to any speakers who come to your group. Our next resource is the new short aphasia videos that you could find on our website. We have one video which talks through how stroke affects your communication, and a second video with the wonderful Jan and Carly demonstrating some different strategies that might be helpful to support people's communication. Remember, what strategies work for one might not work for all, so it's always good to test out and see what works for you and for your group. Next slide. We also have the Getting Online for People with Aphasia guide. This is a resource for anyone who is new to technology or who is having to relearn technology after their stroke. This gives some really helpful step-by-step guidance on things like setting up an email account, sharing pictures, or downloading apps. Hopefully, a lot of you during Aphasia Awareness Month in June had a chance to watch our aphasia documentary, When the Words Away Went. You had a chance to see Julie earlier, who stars in this documentary and did an incredible job. The individuals who were filmed also have just received a Giving Voice Award from the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists, so really worth going to have a watch. Next slide. The other resource that we want to let you know about is Aphasia Software Finder. Now, this is an external website which is run by the Tavistock Trust for Aphasia, but they share up-to-date information about a different aphasia software, as well as some general apps which people with aphasia might find helpful. They also have some information on research which has been done on these resources. Next slide.
So, thanks for listening to us. So I've made a handout from this session, which will be sent out to you after this talk. So again, now for questions. Next slide.
Thank you so much, Caitlin and Janet and Colin and Heidi and Jim. What an incredible session. I was sitting here absorbed and learning so much. I just want to see if Anne is available to come back in and share some of the reflections that you're all sharing around this session.
Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for your comments and questions that you're posting. Please do keep those coming in. We've had some great comments coming in so far. I'll just read a couple out. So what an exceptional session. The explanation about the resources and their development is so helpful. And the implementation and the impact is so helpful to hear. Well done to Caitlin, Janet, Colin and Heidi, you're all stars. And a personal acknowledgement for Heidi from someone called Emma, who met you at the conference back in Nottingham a few years ago, and has really acknowledged how much your speech has improved over those years. So well done to all.
Thank you so much, Anne. That was lovely to hear those comments. Thank you for sharing those with us. And thanks, everyone, for being so engaged in this session. We're going to have a short question and answer for about 6-7 minutes. So I'd love to welcome back Caitlin, Janet and Heidi and Colin, hopefully joining us as well, all being well with the tech. Hello, everybody. Love to see you on screen. Fantastic. So I'm going to go through a few questions that have come in. The first one, Caitlin, maybe for you, just around the communication cards. Is it possible to just order the communication cards by themselves, or do they come in with the pack?
Excellent question. So these little cards, you can order them directly from our website. They're absolutely free to order, and you can just order the cards by themselves.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. We had another question coming in that I'm going to read it out if that's okay. So following my stroke, I have difficulty finding some words. I know there is a word and I have a sense of the word shape, but it won't come. I had quite a large vocabulary before, but I think the stroke stole it from me. The stroke unit said it was probably old age. How do you distinguish? How do you make the difference between stroke and age effects? I don't know if anyone would like to comment on that first. Maybe hand up. And
Colin, I feel like you've unmuted and you want to comment on that.
I think I'm
good.
Unmute. Yeah, we're good. There's a lot of people are like that. They know exactly what they're trying to say, but that the word is exactly what they're saying, and they just can't do it. And it must be horrible that people who are a bit older to say that's because of not about your stroke, it's about yours is a bit older and some of your words just not very good. And I think that's a terrible shame, because I think if you could just keep practice those types of words and then practice every day, you will get better.
Thank you, Colin. It's a really strong message that with practice, things can often improve. Caitlin, do you want to reflect on that as well?
Absolutely. So you can have some language loss as you get older. There is a natural amount of disfluency as well that we all experience. If it's something that you're worried about, I would recommend that you reach out to your GP and ask for a referral to speech and language therapy, because what a speech and language therapist would do would be to do a formal assessment, and they'd be able to identify where those language difficulties are occurring. But Heidi, I imagine that that description of knowing the word exactly but not being able to get it out is exactly what you've experienced before in the past.
Still now, if every day speech, good morning, you know, and it's normal, but that's for practice. But like today is different conversation, so sometimes you have to think harder. And for me, I think forget the words and it come later. If you think over, see it over, you can't use it, and it's not come. So it's in a queue for the next word. So go back, change the subject, or find another word.
It's a great tip, Heidi.
Great tip. Thank you all. There was another question that came through. How can we make doctors more aware of this resource and the resources you've spoken about?
That's a great question, Beth. We've been doing a lot of work, and Janet and Heidi will know that one of the things that we really wanted to get across when we were creating this resource was that healthcare professionals knew a lot more about aphasia as well. And so we've promoted these through the NHS, especially to doctors, nurses, speech and language therapists, so that they are, one, telling patients about these resources, but also that they have an opportunity to read through and understand all the information together as well. We're also going to be promoting this at our big stroke conference at the end of the year, where we have thousands of healthcare professionals, and we're going to be demonstrating it. And Heidi and Janet are actually giving a talk at that conference, along with Jim as well, sharing their experiences creating those resources.
Amazing. Fantastic. It's incredible work, and you must feel also proud to be part of it and to be telling so many people about it. We've got one final question that's come in, which is a really good, interesting question. How can we help people whose first language is not English?
Excellent question. And it really depends on the type of language that they speak, because how the aphasia impacts on someone, how you would then treat them in their therapy could be quite different. So, for example, in English, we read from left to right, but in other languages, they might read from right to left. One of the things that we can do, which we can do today, is use a lot of images to help get our message across, and use things like gesture. So if you're having a conversation, reduce your language, so make it as easy and simple as possible. You might want to do a thumbs up and a thumbs down for yes and no, or you could have pictures of yes and no. Google Translate can be absolutely incredible, so you might want to translate a yes or a no in their language so that you're able to at least engage with some questions. And at the Stroke Association, we do have an interpreting service called Language is Everything. So if a stroke survivor phones us and they need help in a different language, we will get an interpreter to help support those conversations.
Thank you, Caitlin. That's really, really thorough. Lots of information there for people to take away. Before we close this session, Janet, is there anything from your perspective, from your group, and how you support people with their communication? Has there been any challenges on how you support people with communication?
Yes, well, when we first get a new person coming along to the group, usually what happens to them, that person arrives, the confidence is shattered, you know, it's just horrible. But it's once they realise they're in a group with people who've all got the same problem, you can then slowly, over time, confidence starts to grow again, and they start to blossom again. And it's super. And just another tip, talking because I know I have these vision problems, which Heidi has as well. So when we have our group, we make sure if you get to realise what people's problems are, make sure where's the best place for them to sit. So there's always lots of tips of things that can help lots of people. And these little tips can make a big difference.
Absolutely. And I think we could probably talk for the rest of the day on this. There's been so much engagement and so many questions, but I'm afraid we are at time. So thank you all for joining. I want to say a huge thank you. And to say also that there are videos available on YouTube that you can share with groups and that you can share the top tips with your members. So as Janet said, there's a top tips document from this session. Feel free to share all of that with your members. So thank you, Heidi, Caitlin and Janet. And I think we lost Colin at the end there, but thank you as we managed to hear his reflections on a question, which was great. Thank you all. I want to briefly shine a spotlight on two communication support groups who are part of our wonderful network. The first one is Green Hill Aphasia Group in London. As Juliet said, one of their volunteers, Annette Daniels-Smith, won a Coronation Champion Award for her outstanding contribution as a volunteer. There she is on the left of your screen. With so many thousands of applications, it is incredible that Annette and Colin were recognised. It's clear that you as Stroke's volunteers are clearly seen as making a difference and inspiring others. The Green Hill Aphasia Group started in 2005, primarily for stroke survivors who had finished their speech therapy, but who wanted more communication support. The group meets in Stratford, East London, every week. It provides a supportive atmosphere for members to improve communication by signing, gestures, drawing, and writing. They find drawing helps coordination and concentration, as well as being relaxing. The group activities include music, keeping fit, and trips out. They also support other causes. They sent parcels to the Ukraine and they raised money for the victims of the Turkish earthquake. Annette believes that both volunteers and members can make a valid contribution to the Green Hill Aphasia Group. Another wonderful group in the network is Cuckfield Stroke Communication Group. They're based in West Sussex. They aim to support stroke survivors to make new friends, raise confidence, improve communication, and have fun through lots of activities. They do quizzes, golf, music, ballet, and samba rhythm drumming. Keith, a member of the group, said the group has helped his speech, and he tells us that you get to do things here that you wouldn't do at home, whether that's speech, singing, ballet, or art. To me, the group means freedom. You are free to be your own person. The group is also supported by an incredible choir master called Madeline. She believes music boosts mental well-being as well as improving communication. So I look forward to welcoming you back tomorrow, but I will leave you with a beautiful piece sung by the volunteers and the members of Cuckfield Stroke Communication Group.
I did my best to notice when the call came down the line. I took a platform of surrender. I was poor, but I was kind. And sometimes I get nervous when I see